In this video, we'll walk you through a real-world diagnosis of a bilge pump failure in a boat. We'll show how an oscilloscope can sometimes nail down an exact diagnosis. We'll transition an automatic pump system to one with a separate float switch. And we'll dive into the controversial topic of bilge pump check valves.
Good morning, friends and fellow sailors. I've got another bilge pump misadventure I'm going to have to go through with you today. This is going to be a diagnostic video. The last one was 2.5 years ago where I replaced a bilge pump. On this occasion, my wife and I were cruising on the weekend, and she said to me, "Honey, I haven't heard the bilge pump go off." And indeed, I went down to look at the bilge, and this is what we found. Look at all that water. So the first thing I did is I went to the fuse box. This is it here, just to give you a bit of an overview. This is the start battery. I've got two host batteries. This is the incoming power, and that's the alternator wire. And these are fuses for unswitched power. And this is my automatic charging relay. The fuse that we're concerned with is this one right here. And the first thing I found was that this fuse was blown. And so I went on to replace its fuse. It's a 7.5 amp fuse. And it immediately blew so quickly that I barely could tell. So we've got it dead short. Okay, so let's look at what I've done here. I've taken the fuse out, and it's in its place I'm putting two probes that are hooked in where the fuse would be. You can use a pin. You need to be careful not to spread the contacts. And I'm going to, instead of the fuse, I'm going to use this test light. The test light's basically going to replace the fuse. It's a high resistance fuse, and so it won't allow much current through, but it'll tell me whether or not current can get through. And so let's put both ends and let's just watch. And you see that? Did you see that red flash? Let's see if it happens again. So intermittently, we're getting an intermittent pulse of current through, perhaps limited by downstream hardware. Now let's go to the switch. Now here's my switch for the bilge pump, and there are three positions. There's manual, off, and auto. And normally this light is lit. And I've checked this fuse earlier, and the fuse is still good. So I'm going to take it out now, and we're going to see if we still get that flash to try and decide whether or not the problem is upstream or downstream of the switch here. So at this point, by far the most likely diagnosis is this is a bad motor, a shorted motor from shorted windings. Exactly why that may be is hard to say. So as a first effort, I'm going to vacuum out the remaining water to keep things clean, and I'll take out some floorboards. So looking at this here, I'm not seeing anything obvious in the pump. And the wiring here, this is where the connections are. These look good as well, and they seem to be done well. I remember doing them. At this stage, I took the pump home and bench tested it, as shown. Notice that when I power it through the automatic wire, it gives a short pulse and then it quits. Interestingly, when I power it through the manual control wire, the pump seems to work fine and the 7.5 amp fuse I got in line doesn't blow. Average current draw on the clamp meter shown here is about 4 amps. Is there a short circuit on the automatic side of the board? Or is there a problem with the motor that we aren't appreciating on this simple bench test with no head pressure? That distinction is important because it works fine with manual control. I may be able to continue using this pump in manual mode. So, to better look at this, I've set up a scope to measure current waveforms on the bench. After recording these waveforms, I'm going to sit down with you and walk you through what we did next. This will be easier for you to understand if I show you a good waveform first. On the vertical axis, we're measuring current with a scale of minus 5 to 20, and the horizontal axis is one full screen measuring about 2 seconds. This is the new pump. When the pump turns on, we get the anticipated stationary rotor spike of about 12 amps. Then as the motor spools up and produces back EMF, the current quickly falls to about 3.5 amps. Notice there's not much noise, and when the pump is on, you don't get any drops to zero. Let's zoom in. You get a classic regular sawtooth pattern with each hump representing one rotor winding. In the first video I did a few years ago, I showed this rotor has 5 windings, so each full cycle will have 5 humps. The duration of these can vary, but it's worth noting that each hump on this motor lasts about 1 millisecond. Now let's look back at the bad pump shown in red. The Pico records this page by page, and you can see just at the end of a page a much bigger current spike when I turn the motor on at about 17 amps. Let's go to the next page. Wow. Look at all that noise. I'm using the same scale as the good recording. It would be a real mistake to add noise suppression here. You could destroy all of your evidence. The noise is caused by the bad pump. Now let's zoom in. Notice how much wider the swings are in current, with giant peaks of about 7 amps each cycle. But look at this right here. We're getting flat-line troughs all the way down to zero.
Also notice these zero current dropouts are seen with all the humps, so the problem isn't confined to one winding. That's happening because there's poor contact between the brushes and the commutator. If the motor were to stop at one of those bad points, it may not start, but once the motor starts, angular momentum carries the rotor through to the next contact. So that's why this motor works okay if it can spool up. Now imagine what would happen if the motor were to suddenly stop at one of those zero contact troughs. This is the kind of motor that will suddenly let you down, failing to start with open contacts. It's the kind of motor that may respond to that old mechanic trick at the roadside to tap on a fuel pump or a starter motor with a hammer. You're trying to jar the rotor enough to shift the brushes over to the next clean contact. This clip is a good example of why using noise suppression can be misleading. Here's the bass clip I showed you earlier, and here's what it looks like with noise suppression added. By trying to clean up noise, you've lost all evidence of zero current dropouts, and you've lost the high current peaks as well. So you end up with an average that looks pretty close to normal. This is the pattern you'd get with a clamp meter. You've lost critical information you can only get from a scope. I've come to hate automatic bilge pumps. They're noisy and expensive, and when a component fails, you end up having to replace the whole thing. The worst thing about them is that they turn on every 3 minutes, whether they're needed or not. And that means during the summer months, for a long period of time when the bilge is relatively dry, they're still turning on and off every 3 minutes. And that may not be a problem in terms of the cost of energy, but I think it causes erosion of hardware over time. And so rather than replacing this pump a third time, I've decided to switch over to a manual pump with a separate float switch.
Undoubtedly, the reason this boat is fitted with an automatic pump is because the pump cavity is too small to fit both the float switch and the pump together. But these chambers are all connected to the very bottom with large openings, so I've decided it's safe to place a float switch in the adjacent chamber. The trick is to find a way to hold it secure, flat, and forward-facing in the midline without using screws into fiberglass below the waterline.
Gee, I should have been recording this all along, but in any case, using a combination of half-inch and quarter-inch starboard, I've built a little brace to hold the switch in place. The big issue with this switch is that there's nothing to hold it down. It needs to be level, especially side to side. And this is the brace is what I've come up with here. The switch pops in here like so. And I can use these holes to reach the quick release valves. But in any case, I can always unscrew it with a screwdriver. Okay, let's see how this fits. Yeah, and I can set it to whatever depth we need it. That's gonna have to be pretty exacting.
Here's a shot of the backflow preventer. The ABYC have come out against the use of these for bilge pumps because they could possibly obstruct. Unfortunately, in my boat, the length of the 1-inch outlet tubing is about 2 meters to the anti-siphon valve, meaning that every time the pump turns off, almost a liter of water refluxes back into the bilge. On this installation, I tried to get away without using the check valve, but with the small volume in the bilge cavity down low, the water level in the bilge rises so much that the switch immediately turns the pump back on. So I've left it in.
So just to summarize where we're at here, there are two ways that power gets to that brown wire to feed the pump. The first way is through the yellow wire, which comes from a manual control switch up on the wall. And when you flick that manual control switch, it directly powers the brown wire and the pump. The second way is via the red wire, which comes all the way from the battery through a fuse down to the switch. And as soon as the lift switch trips, that sends power to that same brown wire down to the pump. So we got the hose going full blast here, and it looks like the pump is able to keep up with that despite the hose. You can see the switch cycling on and off, so I'm really happy with that. I'm just going to flush the system out a little bit. It's been a while since it's worked. I've used a grinder to take the top of this off, and then we have the commutator right there, and then the two brushes. And I want you to look really closely at those brushes. You can see one of them seems to be gone. That might have come off when I took this apart. The other brush is right there, and there's barely any brush left. Can you see that? Try and show you different views. Now, you might think this is poor engineering, Chinese engineering, but remember that this thing has been going on every 2.5 to 3 minutes for 3 years. And so if you do the arithmetic, you realize that that's over 500,000 starts and stops for this little motor. What do you expect? These motors aren't designed to last forever. But I'm hoping that the new manual motor won't turn on as long and will last longer because it doesn't have to go through so many start-stop cycles. Time will tell.
I hope this video helped you out. Thanks for watching.